Hello again. In this video we will talk about the first and in fact about the only organ in the client's body with which the hands of the massage therapist directly contact. We will talk about the skin. We will briefly review its structure and functions and talk about the impact of massage on it. The skin has many important functions and this determines its complex structure. It has three main layers. The outermost layer is the epidermis, underneath it lies the dermis, and the deepest third layer is the hypodermis or subcutaneous tissue. Some sources, by the way, describe only two upper layers of the skin, and the subcutaneous tissue is described somewhat apart from the rest of the skin, as if it is a separate organ. But in anatomy, the hypodermis is always considered as a part of the skin, and therefore we will also consider the skin as an organ consisting of three layers. Let's take a quick look at each of them. The epidermis, as we have said, is the outermost layer. Its main function is to protect the body from various external influences. It can even be said that the epidermis is a kind of border that must always be under control. The epidermis, even after a shower, is not a model of purity because it is inhabited by numerous bacteria and viruses. And if the epidermis is damaged, they can penetrate into our body and cause various diseases. Also, the epidermis is constantly affected by various chemicals that are in the air and water, but due to the structure of the epidermis, they cannot just easily get into our body. So, what is its structure? If we separate the epidermis from the underlying dermis and enlarge it, we will see a multitude of cells of various shapes, which lie close to each other and are arranged in numerous layers. And between them, we will not see any vessels. The absolute majority of all cells of the epidermis are keratinocytes, which are formed in the deepest layer of the epidermis, in its basal layer. Gradually, as they grow older, they move away from the basal layer, as if pushed out by younger cells to the surface, and at the very end of their life, they turn into flattened dead cells that protect the underlying layers, and which look quite nice with a very strong increase. In the deep layers of the epidermis, we can find special skin cells, melanocytes, which produce a protective pigment melanin. This pigment protects the skin from ultraviolet radiation and thus protects our body from sunlight. The number of these cells is maximal among dark skin people and minimally, on the contrary, in blonde and redheads. And by the way, by the amount of pigment, that is, by the degree of darkness, we can indirectly judge how the skin of a particular person is protected from external influence. For example, some authors of massage textbooks write that people with dark skin usually tolerate a stronger massage a little more easily than those with lighter skin. But this doesn't mean that blondes need only be stroked, and dark ones can be turned inside out. The next is dermis. This is the second or middle layer of skin. This layer is already significantly protected by the overlying epidermis, and its structure is completely different. There are also many different cells here, but there are many fibers between them. These fibers enable the skin to be both durable and fairly elastic. For example, collagen fibers, which are thicker, are responsible for strength, and elastic fibers, which are thinner, are responsible for elasticity. These fibers are composed of proteins, which in turn are secreted by the cells of the dermis. Massage therapists need to take into account the fact that the composition of these fibers is not definitively determined, and it may change under the influence of various factors acting on the skin, including under the influence of massage. In the dermis is also located many different receptors that perceive irritation from the outside, and each type of receptor specializes in its type of irritation. Thanks to them, a person can distinguish between pain, temperature, touch, and pressure. The sensitivity of the receptors is also not constant, but varies under the influence of various factors, such as, for example, the time of day, the degree of fatigue, and some others. In this layer, unlike the epidermis, we can find many blood and lymphatic vessels. There are also sweat and sebaceous glands, which secrete sweat, and sebum on the surface of the epidermis, respectively. Through sweat, the body gets rid of harmful or unnecessary substances, and during the day, under normal conditions, about half a liter of sweat, or even more, is released to the skin surface. In the dermis, there are also hair follicles and muscles that leave the hair. These muscles are unlikely to help their wearer stand out on the beach, as they have microscopic dimensions, and their main task is to increase heat transfer, or on the contrary, to keep the body warm. Moreover, these muscles are not controlled by our will, and maximum at their contraction, we will see goosebumps. The third and deepest layer of skin to which attention is especially riveted is our subcutaneous tissue or hypodermis. This is the very layer of skin where the fatty tissue so hated by many has hidden. This layer contains a certain amount of fat, which is definitely not superfluous in our body. In general, nature is a very competent builder, and therefore everything that exists in our body, and even more so has withstood such a lengthy selection and test of time, is not something random or superfluous. Sometimes it seems to me that some people would agree to exchange the last resource of their fat for a tail or something like that, which was eliminated by evolution for usefulness, rather than working with fatty tissue and fashionable now. But back to the hypodermis. It consists of fat segments which are formed by fat cells, and these fat segments are divided by partitions. The functions of this layer. It is the mechanical protections of the underlying tissues from various heats. This is thermal protection, as fat is a poor heat conductor. Fat is also a depot of certain vitamins and nutrient reserve in case of starvation. Adipose tissue also has hormonal function, which in itself requires respect for it. And despite the fact that adipose tissue performs a number of very important functions in the body, many people still want to get rid of it, and they want to get rid of it without negative consequences for their health. And for losing weight, quite often people resort to massage. Let's say a few words about the development and changes in adipose tissue. The number of fat cells in an adult remains more or less constant throughout life. If an adult is gaining or losing weight, then this is mainly due to the amount of fat in individual cells and not due to a change in the number of fat cells themselves. The number of fat cells in humans is partly laid before birth, namely in the last months of intrauterine life, as well as in the first years of life and during puberty. And this means that the amount of fat cells in any person depends largely on the behavior of their parents. For example, a child, especially in the early periods, does not particularly mind when every meal is stuffed into him. And in childhood, it is parents who determine the size of servings and the quality of food. Therefore, taking this opportunity, I want to say hello to all present and future parents, as well as grandparents, who love to feed their children and grandchildren with something tasty and high calorie. Let's note another interesting point that is not usually mentioned in the massage books. Pay attention to the ratio of skin layers. We see a thin layer of the epidermis, a thicker layer of the dermis, and again a thin layer of the hypodermis. In fact, the hypodermis in many areas is much thicker than the dermis. If we take a look at the absolute dimensions of all layers of the skin, the results will be approximately as follows. The epidermis up to 1.5 mm, the dermis up to 5 mm, and the hypodermis in places up to 10 cm, although in some areas there is no subcutaneous tissue at all. And the last one about the structure. Everything that we have just considered applies to the skin of a healthy adult. That is, at different ages, skin has differences in both structure and physiology. Now let's see how massage affects our skin. We will move from the surface to deep layers. In the epidermis, thanks to the massage, superficial dead cells are removed better, and this, in turn, facilitates and improves the work of the sweat and sebaceous glands. In the dermis, massage increases the inflow of arterial blood, and with it comes more oxygen and nutrients. Also, massage enhances the outflow of venous blood and lymph, which has anti-edematous effect. As a result, local temperature and metabolism increase, and necessary substances begin to remove more quickly, and vice versa, the necessary substances and structures begin to form. Consequently, the conditions for tissues and cells become better, and they perform their functions better. Under the influence of massage also increases the amount of elastic fibers in the dermis. Massage therapists and their clients know this by the fact that the skin with regular massages becomes softer and more elastic. Also, the skin cells begin to actively synthesize and release into the surrounding space various biologically active substances, and thereby increase the efficiency of the underlying muscles and neighboring nerves. And now about the effect on adipose tissue. I don't want to disappoint anyone, but the influence of classical massage on fatty tissue is not as great as some would like. Approximately 100 years ago, in experiments on animals, it was proved that massage with its usual strength and very strong practically does not change the amount of adipose tissue. Fat reserves in the body are not reduced when the fats are beaten, kneaded, or rubbed, but when the energy consumption of the body prevails over its intake from food. And it is with this approach the fats will go to the flow without any massages and other procedures. With the too strong massage, in addition to the fact that there will not be a necessary decrease in effect, damage of the vessels, muscles, and other soft tissues will definitely occur. Some massage therapists and their clients may not agree with this opinion. And as an example, they sometimes cite some of the manual techniques in which the fat stores and the tissues can still decrease. But if we carefully study these techniques, we will see that in order to achieve this effect, a special dosage is necessary. Sometimes it is estimated at several hours of work in a small area of the body. Also, the impact with such techniques falls not only on subcutaneous fat, but also on more deeply located tissues. For example, the authors of such techniques say that the work also happens with the fat that lies between the muscles. The result which is achieved with such a massage goes through a very strong inflammation of the tissues, which can carry certain risks and is not welcomed by the authors of traditional massage techniques. And finally, the authors of such methods themselves do not call it a massage, despite the fact that it is made by hand. In other words, a classic massage does not have a significant fat-burning effect. But this doesn't mean that massage for losing weight is absolutely useless. With regular massage, the blood supply to the skin improves, tissue metabolism increases, muscle fatigue decreases faster, and they recover better after exercise. And as a result, conditions for losing weight are better than those who do not massage at all. And this is how massage affects our skin. If you like the video, click thumb up and share it. If you have questions, you can write them below. See you in the next video.